puts it down. Proctor for three. Nice.
We got three wins, and we got three wins for a reason.
Are we going to make some noise on this tournament?
And the threes just keep falling. We always have confidence to win, but the job's not done yet.
Hello, everybody. The FIBA Asia Cup is upon us again. The second semifinals day, quarterfinals day, excuse me. Australia taking on Japan and then Korea taking on New Zealand. We are starting off with Australia against Japan. The business end of this tournament, Japan coming in here after winning their qualification for the quarterfinal against Philippines. They will not have Yuta Watanabe, unfortunately, because of the injury that he suffered in their last game. So that's basically taking their most important player out of the lineup, which is a huge disappointment, obviously, for Japan and all the Japanese fans and everybody. There's Tom Huvas. And we got a chance to speak to him about Yuta before the game. He says, listen, we're going to give it our best shot against a great Australia team. I'm Jeff Taylor, joined by Mark Mills. And it's just part of sports, Mark. Nobody likes it, but it happens. And, you know, they're going to have the next man up philosophy.
Yeah, absolutely. The one thing you've got in the Japanese roster is they do have depth. They've got double-digit numbers across every player with regards to minutes in this tournament. So I'm ready for the next man to step up. But you're right, this Australian team have looked good, but they're waiting for their first challenge, which I think will come today.
Well, they've had a break. It wasn't a break, really, that Coach Mike Kelly wanted, getting straight to the quarterfinals, but you do want to get straight to the quarterfinals. But it means you don't play for a few days. But anyway, we're going to pause for the national anthems.
Please remain standing for the national anthem of Australia.
Well, two of the top teams in Asia, of course, Australia, the defending champions. They've only got one player from the team that won it in 2017, Mitch McCarron, Maka. And they've got the youngster Tyrese Proctor there, who's off to Duke University to play for the Blue Devils. That's all you need to know about him. And Thon Maker, one of the elite players in this competition, as well as Sam Froehling. But really, Mark, the strength of this Australia team, with Cam Opender as well, the strength of this team is the depth. I mean, there is no drop-off.
No, there isn't. No matter who Coach Kelly brings on the floor, the level, the intensity stays the same. The only question I have about them really is they haven't been challenged yet. They've not been pushed. They've not had any adversity really in this tournament to cope with. And I think Japan could, even without Watanabe, have the option to really push them. Japan have looked good at times. Very, very impressive. Watanabe, you can see, not enjoying maybe sitting on the bench so much, wants to be on the floor. He's that type of player. But for Japan, I think they benefited from that extra game. Obviously, the frustration that they will have had losing Watanabe in that extra game. But for Japan, the must is they must shoot the ball well. It's that simple. If they have a sluggish game from outside, this is going to be a big win for Australia. If Japan can shoot the ball to their potential, Australia have got some problems today.
And Australia, you know, maybe Japan can put some pressure on those Australians as well, force some turnovers. Referees for today's game, Harja Jiladri from Indonesia on the left, Mohamed Duz from Iran on the right, and Zhang Yu from Chinese Taipei in the middle. Well, Japan with Yuta Watanabe are a really good team, and they're a really good team without him. Yuki Togashi, Luke Evans, Yuta Rutsuda, one of the real revelations, had an incredible game against Syria. Yudai Nishida has just been a revelation for me, and Tenketsu Harimoto, the big man in the starting lineup with Watanabe out. And then you got Sato, Kawamura, Tominaga, Taves, Inoue, and Yoshi. And of course, Tom Hovas. Used to be a player himself. Coached the women's national team in Japan to unparalleled heights, really, for their program. Got to the Olympic final in Tokyo and then was offered the men's job and decided it was time for a change. Thon Maker, William McDowell White, Mitch McCarron, Samson James Froling. We just call him the Big Smooth. Samuel McDaniel. And then you've got Dukas Proctor, Swaka, David Aquera, Keanu Pender, Reese Vague, and Steindl. Steindl will not be playing, obviously, because a couple of games ago he suffered a knee injury. Probably looking at 2 months out of action. And Michael Kelly, his first time as the head coach of Australia. Well known in Australian circles, has done a great job. And it's easy to see why they put him in charge of this team. But as you said, this is their biggest test.
Yeah, without a shadow of a doubt, Japan are going to be the toughest competition they've gone against. But Japan have had an up-and-down tournament themselves. You know, they've had some huge games, a historic demolition of Syria. But then they really got unpicked by Iran in that last group game. And then they bounced back for a 21-point win against the Philippines. So if we get the good version of Japan today, then we're in for a very, very interesting game. Contrasting styles, I have a feeling that Australia will primarily get their points close to the basket through and I raised it in other games. We've seen it important that Australia are one of the worst free throw shooting teams in this tournament. They're shooting under 60%. That's going to come back to bite them at some point in this tournament if they don't pick up that percentage.
Let us remind you, folks, go to the FIBA.basketball Asia Cup website or go to the FIBA Asia Cup app, go to the news, and click on who do you think is the Asia Cup 2022 MVP so far, and you can cast your vote now. We are underway in Jakarta, Indonesia, the FIBA Asia Cup quarterfinal between Australia and Japan. Australia winning the opening tip and attacking the basket to the right. Sam Froling comes right out, and wide open shot. And I don't think that's by design to give that to him, because he's proved that he can hit the jump shot.
Yeah, he can. And, you know, pre-game raving about how good Japan are from the perimeter. But Australian team are no slouches. Pretty much everyone in the roster can step out and hit threes. So it could be a perimeter shootout today's game.
And a turnover by Tagashi. Trying to go to Suda. Here's the interesting matchup without Watanabe. Luke Evans gets the Thon Maker assignment. Tagashi pulls up on the break and ties it. Well, sometimes expectations might have been lowered on the outside, and maybe some of the looks were glum for Japan over there on the bench without Watanabe, but you never know. Maybe they'll rise to the occasion, but McDaniel rises to the occasion and gets Australia's second basket.
Yeah, nice bright start by both teams. I think it's what the game wants and needs. And it's interesting to see Togashi get a score straight away.
Pump fake Luke Evans, and he gets blocked by Froehlich. Froehlich back outside to Maka. McDaniel finds Froehlich. This time passes up to three, takes it down low, fades, and gets it to go.
And five early points for Froehlich, and this is the problem you have when you face Australia. You don't know where the offense is going to come from because they can all score the ball.
Tagashi turns it over, his second turnover here in the first 2 minutes, trying to make something happen. Thon Maker, jump, and misses everything. That was good defense by Harimoto.
Yeah, and if Japan are going to take some positives from the start of this game. As you see that block from Froehlich, just stayed with it. It's a great start for Froehlich.
He's even smooth on the blocks, isn't he?
He is. But the highlight for Japan is the fact that Thon Maker's not connected yet. Their defense has been strong enough to keep them out, as we see Togashi Jane in the three.
Tagashi pulls up at the elbow, high arcing shot. Australia not giving away much at all. And in it goes to Thon Maker, and he's fouled.
And that right there is the problem on the switch. I'm not sure they really want to be switching away from Thon Maker. Evans came out on the switch and no one rolled with Thon Maker to the basket. And Ishida, I think, was the one tasked with trying to stop the unstoppable. And he had no luck.
So it looks like more of the same for the teams facing Australia, although they did have a handful against host Indonesia for the first 15 minutes. And Australia had the hands up, and they're cutting off those passes. You know, you talk about they'd like to have Rui Hachimura here. He couldn't play. Udai Baba, who's played in Australia, they'd like to have him as well. But Suda missing everything.
It's a rarity. Japan not looking confident. You wonder how much has played into their mind losing. Losing their leader, really.
McDaniel open for three. And then the handoff to McDaniel. And Thon Maker takes it away. And then puts it up and takes it up to a 12-3 lead.
And I said it in the opening, if Japan can't hit threes, then this is going to be a really tough game for them. They're not going to win this game inside the paint. They're going to win this game by ball movement on the perimeter and open shots.
Here's Nishida for three. Rattles out. Yuki Kawamura is going to come into the game for Japan at the next dead ball.
Australia going to make three substitutions at the next dead ball. That's confidence for you on your team.
Ooh. And McDaniel goes through his hands, and now chance to run. Suda and Maka impedes the progress. Luke Evans into the corner it goes. Harimoto
That told you a lot as well. When Luke Evans turned the corner and the lane was open, he didn't attack it. There wasn't any aggressive drive to the basket. He looked for the pass.
Well, he's already had one shot rejected by Froehling. Macca looks over at the ref. Froehling helps him up. So Kawamura comes in, as does Inouye. So Soichiro Inouye. And talking, and Dukas Proctor and Kano Pender, Rhys Vague, all come in for Australia. Talking to Hovas before, he's like, hey, listen, no matter what happens, we've uncovered a few things that are going to help us. We've uncovered a few things or made a few discoveries about the Japan team while here that's going to help us moving forward. But it's not helping them right now as Macca drills a three-pointer, is up to a 15-3 lead.
You know, Australia entered this tournament as pretty big favorites. They've not really put a foot wrong so far, and the start to this game has been very, very impressive. You have to remember Japan have been one of the best teams in the tournament.
And so Kawamura, his speed, quickness, Macca gets over and bumps him.
For me, Kawamura has been slightly underused. The only issue you have with Kawamura is he's just not a scorer. He's not looking to get
he's
to the basket
primarily to dish.
Yeah.
His handle, Yoshi's coming in.
For me, I think his handle is probably the best within the Japanese team. You know, if it was just pure on a point guard, who can facilitate, who can bring the ball up the floor, I think he's probably the best option. But that basically means you've only got four players on the floor that will look to score the ball.
Luke Evans goes in, tries to score with the left hand. Tominaga's checked in. He's guarding the ball. Kasei Tominaga plays at Nebraska in the USA. College basketball, just like this young man does. He plays for St. Mary's, one of the many Australians that have gone to St. Mary's. In California, the Gales. Three-point shot in the U. I think that might be one of the players. He might be one of the players that Hovas was alluding to when he talked about one of the discoveries that they've made.
Yeah, I think so. He's a really nice, versatile player for him. You can see offensively he can step out, hit the three, but defensively he's a good body as well. He played some good defense.
Boy, great catch by Macca over to Vague. You knew that was in. He just doesn't miss, does he?
Yeah, no, that's near money for Vague. You can't give him that space. He shot 42% from outside in the tournament.
The way he shoots it, he should change his name to Certainty. There's nothing vague about that. And this is, again, McCarron finding him. So Japan called timeout, trailing 18-6. Slow start against the Boomers. That's never a good thing.
Oh, energy, high rotation, good energy. Aggressive, active.
Aggressive, now.
Okay?
Active
oh, hush there. Okay, I think I hike them all. Hike and
even if they score.
And I think Coach Hovas is absolutely right. Pace. Bring the ball up the floor quickly. Make the Australians have to play some transition D. Even if you know you're not going to get into a transition offense, just make them have to work in both directions. At the moment, Japan just seem very submissive in this game. They're just letting Australia completely rule the tempo of the game, how it's being played, and well, that's why they lead by 12 so early in the game.
So it's a full court pressure, and Kawamura gets it up to Tominaga. He's not going to miss a round, and he's going to nail the three. And that might play into Japan's hands, full court pressure.
And Tominaga struggled in that last game, but throughout the tournament, he has been a red hot from outside.
And Kawamura fouls Proctor. This is Tominaga. That's how he probably will earn a living one day, shooting those long jumpers, the son of a Japan national team center. Of course, he's a lot smaller, but I think he probably shoots it a lot better. The pass, McDowell White into the game and gets it right back. Yoshi. And good hesitation. Keanu Pender flew right by, going for the block.
Yeah, wonderful patience and composure from Yoshi, just 24 years old. And again, I think that's the kind of thing that Coach Hovas is talking about.
Reese Vague misses that. McDowell White, look at the hustle from McDowell White. Those are the areas that you don't think about that much, but ultimately Australia will get some extra efforts like that and get extra points. But that was Yoshi. The pause.
And to a certain degree, you can tell the coach Kelly knows how dangerous Japan can be, because as soon as they got in a little run, back into the game comes Maker.
Colin Moore. Oh, he gets rejected by Thon Maker, but Tominaga gets it, and it works out better for Japan as Tominaga flashes the three fingers up to the stands. Dukas catches it. Back to McDowell White. Proctor. And, oh, Colin Moore picks his pocket. Back outside to Tominaga, and Australia cover him well. Great hustle back on D by the Boomers. Karamura, quick pass. Now they're looking good in OU. And good hand in the face by Sam Froling.
Yeah, great scramble defense by Australia there. Japan did a great job, but just the defense was too much.
Dow White, a little hard. And Proctor beats Japan to the ball. An unsportsmanlike foul has been called on Inouye. And unfortunately, you're just going to have to give that one to Thon Maker. And now they've got a chance for a big trip down the floor.
Yeah, I think if he hadn't grabbed his arm, he would have got away with it if he just reached in and tapped him. But it's that grab.
Yeah.
Just becomes dangerous at that point.
He's got to know better than that.
Yeah,
great. Look at Thon Maker.
And that's exactly why Coach Kelly brought him back in. Japan was starting to get a little bit of rhythm on the offensive end. And that's why Thon Maker's in the game, because you know there's going to be very few easy buckets inside when he's on the floor for Australia. Exciting for Japan, though, to see Tominaga starting to warm up, starting to find his form.
Just a little bit of trivia. His dad, I talked to about him, it's Hiroyuki Tominaga. And he played for Japan at the FIBA Basketball World Cup in 1998. But they did not play Australia there. That would have been a nice little story. Unfortunately, and the ball ends up, and they've called a foul on Kawamura, who was protesting a little bit, called for a push. Well, at least Japan are fighting here.
And of all the teams that are in this tournament, though, if they go down by a deficit, it's Japan that can get themselves out of it, averaging almost 100 points a game. So they know they can score the ball and score it in a hurry.
And Froling just doesn't miss, does he? Yoshi. Thon Maker looks lively on both ends of the floor. Kawamura to Tominaga. Boy, how do you guard that? I mean, he's falling out of bounds.
Yeah, that's unreal. And he just looks up to the Japanese fans off the baseline, and they're enjoying what he's doing. And he's keeping them in the game right now.
Well, they don't call him Kasei Greenlight Tominaga for nothing. It's Tyrese Proctor for three. Bounce pass, Tominaga this time goes inside. Boy, he's off to a big start today.
Yeah, 11 points and four from the field. I'm not sure Coach Hovas could have asked for much more from him.
Big Sam Froling left open this time. Gonna run the offense, hands it off to Proctor. Proctor misses, but Froling able to knock it outside for another chance, and McDowell White hits the three. And that's one thing you can't do for Australia. You can't give them those, or you can't allow them to get those offensive rebounds.
No, you really can't. The problem you've got at the moment is Japan are having to crash the paint. Whenever Australia go into their offense, they're having to crowd the paint.
Tominaga again, not this time.
Just too deep for Tominaga on that one.
And up ahead to Big Smooth. Lead is 14 for the Boomers.
What a first quarter. 33 points in the first quarter for Australia. That is some serious offense.
Kawamura from downtown, right at the buzzer. So that gives Japan a lift as they go back to the bench. But Australia having the better of the exchanges. Even so, the game is picking up here in Jakarta. Australia lead it 33-22 at the end of one.
And you don't have to be a rocket scientist to pick this one apart. It's inside where Australia are doing the damage. 6 from 11 inside the three-point line. Froehling and Thonmaker, their leading scorers. They have combined for 16 points out of the 33. As Watanabe is the cheerleader from the bench today. A big loss, but the Japanese aren't backing down. And you feel if the Japanese can find a way to solve that interior scoring, if they can stop Japan getting easy points in the paint without giving up all that space on the perimeter that they have so far, then they have a chance for the upset. But it's a big ask when Australia have got players like that man there, Thonmaker. He is really, really difficult to stop. He's such a versatile player, so many weapons in his arsenal that he can hurt you with. It's a big ask to stop him.
And his defense has already come to the fore as well in this game. He and Froehling, each of them with blocks in the first quarter. Tominaga has essentially just kind of kept Japan on a respirator in this game because they were looking at a really pretty disturbing scoreline there until he came in.
Yeah, 11 points. He's only been on the floor 5 minutes, 3 from 4 outside.
Hey, folks, download the Courtside 1891 app. Video streams, scores, schedules. It is a terrific, terrific app to have in your smartphone. Second quarter action is underway. Kai Taves has checked into the game, gives Japan maybe a little bit more size. And Froehling coming up, knocking it out from Inouye. 17 on the shot clock. Tominaga is going to inbound the basketball. Tominaga gets it back, rims out, and ball is knocked out of Maker's hands, but McCarron picks it up. Tom Maker in there battling away for position with Takuma Sato. Now he's got it further away from the basket. Loops it over the shoulder pass into Froehling. Just patiently. And then Maker goes up and gets the rebound. How do you compete against that if you're Japan?
I'm not sure you can. It's a simple answer. I think they're going to have to drop into a zone defense. They're going to have to give up some outside shots because just looking at that, you know, two offensive rebounds, and then they have to drag him to the floor to stop him. I think Coach Hovas will need to swap into some form of zone defense, even if it's just to break this momentum at the moment, because Australia must feel nearly invincible.
And the lob pass intended for Maker, but he couldn't get to position. And another chance for Japan.
Yeah, smart defense by Yoshi. Just stepped across Thonmaker, bumped the cutter to stop him getting to the lob.
Ball handed off to Kai Taves. Quick pass over to Tominaga and takes a contact and hits it. So McDowell left kind of bit on the pump fake, and having seen him leave his feet, he just kind of leaned into him, didn't he? Watch this.
Super smart play, super clever play. And he made sure that he created enough space that the shot attempt wasn't just a Hail Mary. It was actually a relatively controlled attempt.
If he made contact, it was barely because McDowell looked like he had a little bit of space there. But I suppose Japan due for a break. Tominaga is just...
he's come to play, right?
He's looking Yutaro Suda-like tonight.
He's literally... Tominaga, I find so interesting. So many players try to be two-way players. Tominaga clearly sets his stall out and says, I'm just going to score the ball. That's why I'm on the floor. No other reason. I just want to score the ball.
Here he is. Oh, boy. Good defense from McDowell White, knocking it away. And then Froehlich says, what am I waiting on? I'm going to take it up the floor. And now he gets it back. Pulls his way in. And Yoshi commits the foul. Froehlich has been excellent tonight.
When we saw this actually in the other quarterfinal where Lebanon took on China, if they can spread their fouls, Japan, because this is what Lebanon did against China, they made sure they didn't give up any easy points in the paint, even though they knew they were undersized. If Japan can do the same, spread their fouls, don't give Australia easy points, then maybe that's a good strategy for them to try and limit the damage that's being done.
Australia called the timeout.
Attack, 2 feet in the paint, finish strong. Space, kick out for open threes, right? Down there, make them go through a body. If we switch, find somebody. It's not okay to switch and then relax. It's switch, now I'm here, and we're guarding the ball like that, okay? I don't like this shit. They're trying to body us, and we're moving because they're trying to body us. Strong and finish. Strong and finish. Here we go. Green's on defense.
And it's a message he's been putting out through the entire tournament that it's, you know, go to the basket, go strong, get your feet into the paint, go to the rim hard, and if the shot's not there, you know there's going to be people to kick it out to. And it's clear Japan have come in to be physical today. You know, they've come in, they want to play physical basketball both ends of the floor. They want to draw contact on the offensive end, and they are not going to give you easy points defensively.
Froehlich. Yeah. You talked about the free throw shooting, how it might impact things later. So here's the thing, Japan have taken Tominaga out, and now it's up to Suda to keep those points flowing. And you wonder if Tominaga might check back into the game sooner rather than later.
I think they'll see if Suda can start getting himself in. He missed his first. But if he can start getting warm as well, that two-pronged attack with Tominaga could be huge.
How about that three from Yoshi? Now back to a five-point deficit.
And Japan have been shooting pretty much 40% from outside. They have really leaned on that three, and when it's worked, they've looked unstoppable. When it dries up, though, they become a bit fragile.
McCarron over to Froehlich, spins. There he is from the baseline, takes the contact, still makes the shot.
This is the best Froehlich's looked in this tournament, and he has looked good throughout the tournament, but now he's up to 11 points and putting in a great performance for Australia. He just does things so simply.
Suda, high arcing three, rattles out. He's not missing by much on that one.
And I feel that's why Coach Hovas has put him into the game. He knows that he needs him to find some form as well, get some shots up and shoot himself into action.
Sato now charged with, oh boy, Inouye got lost on defense. I guess he didn't know that Froehlich was behind him, but very clever play by Thon Maker.
It was good positioning by Froehlich as well. He made sure he found the blind spot on that defense and really just snuck to the basket.
There she fouled by McCarron. That's his second. Proctor, Vague, and Waniswaki coming into the game for Australia. That was the replay of that pass to Froehlich. Froehlich goes out with 13 points. Going to frustrate Japan, turning it over cheaply.
Yeah, Sato's not had the best of tournaments. He won't be particularly happy with some of the performances he's put in.
I think they reset the shot clock. Only five on it. Is that right? McCarron gets in.
I think this is a turnover and it goes to the 14.
Oh, okay. And the ball bounces out to Proctor again. Japan in a zone right now. And Vave! Twisting layup.
And this is where the strength of Australia is. They've got big guys like Vague who can shoot the three, but they're quite happy bodying up and getting to the basket as well. Gives such flexibility for Coach Kelly to work with.
Man, really passing it, moving it, trying to find something. Kai Taves, oh, same play, but he wasn't able to finish it, and the ball went out of bounds. So he'll stay at this end. Kai Taves made the right move. Look at Vague. He is a very skilled player, isn't he?
Find me an Australian player that isn't. That's how it feels when you see them rotate.
We were talking to Reese Vague about his first name, if he had any Welsh connections. He said, nope, parents just liked it. He's like, but nobody knows how to spell it. R-H-Y-S, right?
Yeah.
Yudai Nishida. Suda from the left. Under pressure from Keanu Pender. Lonnie Swaka looking for his first points. Here's Pender backing up and just kind of powering his way up over Suda.
And that interior onslaught from Australia is just relentless. They've got so many good front court players that are coming through and rotating into the five on the floor that it just doesn't stop.
Harimoto, that's a little long. And it's like you said, when the threes stop falling, Japan look a little lost. Maka for three, and Kai Taves is going to stay at this end. And even in that situation, it's difficult to keep the Australians off the boards.
Yeah, it really is, and that's, you know, that's the long and the short of it right now. Australia dominating inside, and Japan, I don't think, have any way of stopping them. I'm amazed they haven't gone into a zone, though. They haven't tried something different.
22 rebounds for Australia, 8 for Japan. Proctor, three-pointer, and the lead has grown now to 16 points, the biggest in the game. And Harimoto fouled by Pender.
Yeah, I don't think Pender likes the call, but I think it's the right call. Harimoto just had stole a half step on him. And now Pender was trying to play a little bit of catch up with his body. But Coach Hovas is going to have to change something defensively. You know, you do the same thing, don't expect different results. Australia will continue to dominate there.
Harimoto takes the contact from Vague.
And then just winded Vague a little bit there as well, I think. And I don't believe particularly it's at this offensive end that's a major issue. Yes, Japan rely way, way too much on the three-pointer. You know, that's evident to anyone. But I think they're still keeping the scoreboard ticking over, which is fine. It's the other end of the floor. They've given up 44 points in under 16 minutes of basketball.
And Japan will take anything they can get right now. They get a free throw to drop. Back to a 14-point lead for the Boomers. Now some full-court pressure for Japan. And Australia were ready. Dow White. Ooh. Pender. And good job, Tominaga, who's come back into the game. And I think, you know, he's going to get his shots up here. And he just goes right past Froehling. But then Pender comes and helps out for the SWAT.
And sometimes Tominaga just tries to little showcase, a little showboating too much. And if he'd just gone to simple basketball, he'd have probably drawn the foul.
Yeah.
just gone jump stop, explode to the basket, protect the ball, and just wait. Froehling, Pinder, one of them would have brought their arms down on top of him.
Froehling, right down the lane, lays it up and in. Huge first half for Sam Froehling.
7 from 8 from the field. He's such an efficient scorer.
Higashi and Nishida. And they're having to take really difficult shots. And they're not getting the rebounds off those misses. Proctor, meanwhile, comes down. Look at Froehling. He was not in position for that. Was able to reach over Evans and get the basketball. Dow White, a little bit of a fade there. Another rebound, Froehling. And even Aquera comes in and had a chance for the offensive rebound.
Haramoto's looking a little bit blowing at the moment. And Coach Hovas will have to make a change. Haramoto seems to be the go-to defensive stopper. Luke Evans hasn't really stepped into the game too much for me right now. He needs to stand up and be counted.
Shooter's been pretty quiet today. Togashi steps back and misses everything.
And Japan have never been about creating their own shots. They've always been about running for a team set to create that space.
Dukas. Well, I'll show you a couple of possessions where they haven't scored. So Japan missing some opportunities here to get closer. Into the corner, Tominaga. Australia very quick to the basketball. Oh, look at that. Aquera knocks it away, and Nishida is able to get it back. Tominaga, that's his range. He hits another one.
I love that you just smoothly say that's his range when he's standing on the logo in the midcourt. I just love that because it is. That's his range. He can step out 2-3 meters from the line and still hit the three. Phenomenal.
Aquera misses. Hits his range again, and that time it was a little long. Wonder if he feels more comfortable shooting it from there.
Yeah, and he knows he's going to get the space. You know, he knows he's going to get the open shot if he steps that far back, and I think he prefers an open distance shot than a challenge closer one.
Well, it's just a one spell of play where Australia on offense anyway haven't had it all clicking. Tominaga, another three-point attempt. And Luke Evans falls over, hustles up. Australia quickly down the court. I guess with Tominaga, you just have to let him shoot it, don't you? Dukas.
Yeah, he's not a player that I don't think he understands a red light. You know, he is green light all the way. Whenever he thinks he's got a shot, take the shot. And from Coach Hovas's point of view, you don't want to limit him. He's the only player that really offensively has been very impressive today for Japan. As there's the near logo three. Takes himself to 14 points. And he's not getting out of hand. You know, in previous games, we've seen him get to like 1 from 7 when he struggled. He's currently 5 from 8. That's good shooting percentages from a guy that's taking very, very low percentage shots. You know, tough opportunities. What I'd love to see from Japan on the offensive end is Tominaga and Suda to be on the floor at the same time. Because I think that would actually help Suda, because Australia would have to overcommit to Tominaga, which may create some more space for Suda to get himself going.
One of two for Harimoto, but it's back to a 12-point deficit. So a couple of times it's looked like Japan were reeling and really in trouble, but they've been able to get it back to within striking distance. McCarron, oh boy, that takes care of that, doesn't it? Back up to a 15-point advantage. Togashi, entry pass to Evans.
And so Hovas appealing for a travel.
Yeah, but he only traveled because there was a mistake with the shot clock. The shot clock buzzer went off, and that they all thought it was the end of the half buzzer, and that's why Australia kind of slowed down and stopped.
You can see the problem as well. Luke Evans, the tallest player there, going up against McDowell White, who's a guard, and McDowell White's not giving much away.
But why is he going up that way as well? For a big man, if you have the oversize, if you think you have that advantage, you don't go up weak like
you
that. You
it.
Go up body.
Yeah.
You know, it's two-footed. It's strong. You're leaning in. You're keeping the ball away. It's just a. At the moment, I think Luke Evans just isn't in the game. I don't know what he's distracted by, but he's not being the factor they need him to be. He's open three from the field. He's only got two rebounds. He's been on the floor almost 11 minutes now. They need him to step up and have a big game. He's averaging nearly 12 points and 7 rebounds a game. And he has been a part of why they've looked good this tournament.
Proctor comes back in, takes in McCarron for three, and it was online, but it was short. So, well, I think it could be worse for Japan, but I'd say 15 points is probably, they'll have to settle for that. Australia have really, really been pretty dominant inside. They lead it 49-34 over Japan.
Yeah, and you're absolutely right. I think Australia would be relatively happy with that 15-point lead at the half. You look at their shooting, 44% from outside, 46% from inside. But for me, the difference has been inside. Australia have just dominated the paint. Look at the rebounding numbers, 31-13. Japan have just not come into this game and looked after those boards. And if that's the case, Australia are hot favourites. Tominaga might lead all scorers with 17. He's the one that's kept them in the game, scoring half their points. And then the big smooth Froehling with 15 out of the 49 for Australia.
Here's a look back at the action in the first half. And Australia, well, they gave away this one to Tominaga, three-point play. Kai Taves in the game, passing over to Yoshi, who makes the jump shot. But you can see that Australia have gone to the big smooth. Sam Froehling more times than not. He delivers. And if he doesn't score, he gets the rebound and puts it up and in, or somebody else does. Reese Vague also coming in. So just a big, big task for any team here at the Asia Cup to beat this Australia team.
Yeah, and at the moment it's Australia that are dictating the way this game's being played. Japan, traditionally within this tournament, they've put a lot of pressure on the ball. They've forced a lot of turnovers. They've scored a lot of points from those turnovers. Tonight they've scored 3 points from turnovers. They are averaging 26 points from turnovers. And that just shows you how this game's changed. Japan, offensively, I don't think they're doing too bad. Defensively, they need more pressure on the ball, and they need to work out a way just to stop the interior scoring that Australia are getting easily, because it's not even a struggle for them. You know, offensive rebounds for Australia in that first half, 12 offensive rebounds. They've scored 15 second chance points. You're not going to beat a team the quality of Australia if you give them that many possessions more than you get.
So even with Tominaga coming out and having a big game today, shooting the basketball, 4 of 8 from three-point range, 17 points, it's just not enough against a team that has so many weapons and particularly starts strong. Big three-pointer there from Mitch McCarron. We're at halftime, Australia on top, 49-34 in the quarterfinals against Japan.
Who will you become when the moment arrives and you're carrying the expectations of an entire nation? Representing your people and their dreams, the colorful faces in the streets, the screaming fans in the stands. It's time to make your move. All eyes on you, all hope, all heart. Because when you win for all.
Kim Bao, what a slick pass that was from number 28.
And that is great team offense. Kim Bao just looking for the backdoor cut from Aram, and Aram timing it perfectly.
You can hear the crowd is getting into it. And Bolden finally able to throw it down and earn a trip to the line. Abu Hawass. What a sensational finish! The man can fly. Look at this.
Look at Wild step back. And he gets in. Then the runner.
Wild Araki just has taken over the game.
Just give him the ball and let him win you the game. That's how it feels with Araki and Lebanon.
Look at that passing. Tominaga, good.
Showing the three-point side.
Look, they got a hurry. They're going to get the three. Good. Gets blocked. El Garwich has the basketball. Lebanon has shot China. Unbelievable.
Arledge
gets swatted by Joe T.
What a tremendous block that was by Joe T.
Coming up on the 1 minute mark here. And Dwyer goes in, and boy, does he put the Saudi on the poster.
You feel kind of bad for Al Halsawi.
Maybe
a bit naive.
He'll be having nightmares for weeks on that one.
Guess that's not to pick up a third foul. Freddie. Oh, he was going in for a dunk.
That's great defense leading to fast break offense.
The 2 point game, Zetabas. It might be a three anyway.
Abraham.
Oh! I don't believe
you
it.
Are kidding.
You cannot believe it. It is stunning. Stunning saves in Jakarta. Incredible.
Welcome back to Jakarta. Halftime here in the quarterfinal of the FIBA Asia Cup 2022. Australia versus Japan, and Australia looked good in that first half, continuing to hold on to their favourites moniker that they've had throughout this tournament. They lead 49-34, and it's in the paint that they've done a huge amount of their damage, out rebounding Japan by 31-13. But Tominaga for Japan has done everything he can to keep his team in the game. Toughest shot of the half there, falling out of bounds, and nails the three.
at the half. He has 17 points, 4 from 8 from outside. He's only been on the floor 11 minutes. He needs the rest of his team now to step up and contribute. Next highest scorer within Japan has only 5 points, and that's Yoshi. As for Australia, they've looked comfortable at times, no more so than Sam Froehlich. A big Smooth got to the halfway stage with 15 points, 3 rebounds, but the impressive thing is his efficiency, 6 from 8 from 2, 1 from 1 from downtown. But they've really spread the load. 9 players for Australia scoring in that first half. Plenty of rotation, everyone getting on the floor. And they've looked good, looked very, very strong, and they've imposed themselves on the game. And this certainly seems to be an Australia-style game rather than a Japanese-style game right now.
Australia with a lot of cushion now up against Japan, and you would expect them to want to come out and lower the boom here in the third quarter. But Australia, if they win this game, they will take on Korea or New Zealand, who play next. And I suppose Korea is, you know, it's a young New Zealand team that's been playing pretty well after losing their first game against Lebanon. Of course, Lebanon have revealed themselves to be a really good team.
Yeah, they really have.
But you know, Korea have been one of the better teams here as well. I'm just trying to think if they might cause some problems for Australia. On this evidence, Australia look like they can probably handle anybody in this tournament.
Yeah, potentially. I'm frustrated, obviously, with the injury that Watanabe picked up. I think it would be a very different game. I'm pretty sure it wouldn't be a 15-point game, and I'm also pretty sure that Australia wouldn't be completely dominant in the paint like they are now if Watanabe was playing. But I still think there's more to come from Japan. You know, they trail by 15. It's quite a lot, but they're also a high-scoring team, and I don't think they're anywhere near as good as they can be. You know, let's be honest, on the offensive end, the only player that's playing well is Tominaga. If they can get one or two more players to step up, then they can quickly eliminate this gap. I don't think this game is done and dusted. I'm sure Coach Kelly has been hammering home that message in the locker room to his team. Australia cannot be complacent in the second half. They need to start that third quarter the way they did the game. And like you say, they want to close this game out before the end of the third quarter. They don't want to leave the door open for Japan in that fourth quarter, because if Japan get hot, then how do Australia counter that?
Well, Hovas would like to have Watanabe sprained his ankle. I guess he kind of rolled his ankle in that last game on a fast break, which was unfortunate.
Yeah, it didn't look like a bad flip of the ankle, but I think because he was at full pace, that was the problem.
I don't know. Clint Steindl on crutches there. You just saw him pop into the picture. Australia would like to have him as well, one of their veterans, leaders, and great shooters in this team. I guess what impresses me most about Australia, though, is their overall defense. I mean, it's just like a blanket, isn't it?
Yeah, it's been tough. There's times where Japan have played some wonderful offense. They've moved the ball quickly. They've made some good, you know, set runs. They've run the pass that they needed to run, but they then turn the corner and Australia have just scrambled. You know, there's at times it's not necessarily structured defense that's won the day for Australia. It's just the fact that when their defense is broken down, they've scrambled hard. And that's why Mitch McCarron is such a good player.
Yeah.
Any moment he can to learn more, to deal with those finer details. Exactly where are we running? How are we running? How do we adapt to this situation?
Coach, you know? Macca.
Yeah. I think you can definitely see in the future that he will move into that kind of role.
Well, there's a lot to like about that Australia team. There's the angle from our roving robotic camera on wheels. Nobody's guiding it. It's remote controlled. There it is. See it? It's in the screen.
Japan!
Japan, will this be, here you go, look at this, the FIBA Asia Cup app. Download that into your smartphone, and I have to say it's a valuable tool. I use it probably at least once or twice an hour here in Jakarta. Team roster information, scheduling, whenever I want to check out and see who's leading the fan vote for the MVP of this competition, which, by the way, you can all take part in. Who are you voting for, Mark? Is that a secret?
I can't tell you. It wouldn't be fair for me to show favorites.
Would you vote for yourself if you were in there?
No, sadly not. I'd love to think I could be in that poll. I'm just glad they're not doing a commentator of the tournament poll. Otherwise, that might make me sad. I would claim I came second, though, not last.
So the long look of Luke Evans, and we're ready to go. Second half action is underway. Mitch McCarron takes the inbounds ball, Australia leading it. And look at Luke Evans. I think he must have heard you talking at halftime because he's come out and deflected the first pass out of bounds. Australia on top, 49-34.
And I can understand it's difficult for Evans because when Watanabe is in the team, he has to take a different role. But when he's not, he has to step up and be that frontline go-to big.
It's Harimoto guarding Thon Maker, who has to go to the jump hook, and it's just a near impossible situation guarding Thon Maker. If he's not dunking, he's hitting jump hooks.
Yeah, I think what you need in that situation is you need a guard to come down from the top and help down. There needs to be a double down. If Harimoto can keep him like that, then the guard has to help out to stop him from just going over the top, really.
But the difference there is if that interior pass for goes in at Australia, they're going up towards the rim.
Yep.
Luke Evans is having to
fade
to pass it back outside.
Yeah.
Or look for somebody to pass it to. That's how quick Australia are on defense, and also how tall they are. Tagashi, high arcing shot over Thon Maker.
That was precision. Thon Maker is one of the best shot blockers in this tournament, if not in the world. And to be able to just float that little teardrop perfectly in. Great play.
There's McDaniel getting it inside and putting it up and in. I used to have a branch shooting off from a tree in my driveway where I had my basketball goal, and I had to shoot over it. I used to pretend it was Mike Jaminski. Here we go. Tagashi, you have to learn how to shoot those high arcing shots for games just like this. Three-pointer is good from Nishida.
And this is what Japan need, you know. It's all well and good them leaning on Tominaga, but they need other players to start warming up and hitting shots from outside. Otherwise, it's easy to stop Tominaga.
Maker off the back of the iron.
Maker's not a bad perimeter shooter, but you'd much rather that's where he was putting shots up from.
Suda! One player that can't get it going yet. And Suda was about to dive for that ball. He was so good against Syria. Obviously, it's a very different opponent, but it was like the eighth wonder of the world the way he played. Ooh. Oh, look at Froling. Oh, he missed the layup. He did everything. He wasn't so smooth on the finish, but everything else looked good.
I think that was his easiest attempt of the game as well.
Tagashi for three. Well, Japan not going away. Australia spreading it out, giving Maker a little room. Now they get it to Froling. And Australia's sputtering a bit here at the start of the second half. Luke Evans going up, and he has to go up strong and follows up his miss and still can't get it to go down. And it's just been that kind of game for Luke Evans, and McDaniel goes right back to the other end, follows up his own miss. McDaniel. And the ball goes back over to Japan. It's really frustrating for Japan, but also Luke Evans. I mean, he's trying to make it, and sometimes these things happen.
Yeah, like I say, I think it's difficult for him to just flick that switch from being maybe secondary and being the support player, or being, you know, the front court player that's hustling down offensive rebounds, to being the guy that they look to in the paint to create something.
I mean, there hasn't been a harder worker at this FIBA Asia Cup for Japan than Luke Evans.
No.
That's not in doubt. Just his role has changed, like you said. Here goes Harimoto. Well, they're trying to establish something inside. Tyrese Proctor in the game, vague, give and go, and a bump and a foul called. So Yutaro Tsuda called for the foul.
It's been a good start to the second half for Japan, you know, outscoring Australia 8-4, but you still don't have that confidence about Japan on either end of the floor just yet. When we've seen them at full flow, it's been absolutely wonderful, but I don't think they're quite there. I don't think they have that 100% belief in themselves yet.
Dukas, the youngster, over to Reese Vague. Steps back for three, count it. The vanilla gorilla strikes again. Wonder who gave him that nickname. They should get a prize. Harimoto.
Wow, four changes for Coach Hovas.
Yep, so it'd be Kawamura.
In fact, five changes.
Yep. Wholesale.
Yeah. That's interesting.
Watanabe is not one of them. He would like to be.
Yeah, he's on his feet. He can't help himself on the bench. He's desperate to get on the floor, isn't he?
Tominaga. Kawamura. Making Australia work, and work they do. McCarron blocks the ball out of bounds.
Yeah, and Tominaga saying, just shoot the ball. Kawamura, I don't know what it is, whether he has a mental block to take the shot or what it is, but he needs to.
And good finish there in to Inouye. I think Kawamura is waiting as long as possible to make the pass before he takes the shot. That's what it is.
And that's causing him problems. That's not good form. He has to have that confidence in his own abilities.
Dukas for three.
And fourth time lucky for Dukas.
Tominaga for three, gets it back.
Yeah, he is the saving grace at the moment for Japan.
Keanu Pender, he hits a three. The NBL's most improved player last season with Cairns. And great defense by Dukas to knock it away. And then Vague makes certain of it. Just lays it up and in. 17-point advantage.
Yeah, and that's the thing. Japan have worked so hard to trim that lead. And then Australia just extend it further.
And Dukas is really playing well since the last minute or so. He's coming back into the game. Oh boy, how about that? Former Arizona Wildcat Pender. Lead is now 19 points. Yoshi has to pass it back out. Kawamura, he's going to go past him. And gets it to go, a la Mugsy Bogues.
And that's a smart play. Anytime Kawamura looks up and he's being guarded by a Vague type player, then just drive past him. There's no way Vague was ever going to have the foot speed to stay with him.
And Vague thinking Proctor was cutting to the basket.
And that's good defense. Proctor needs to be a little bit more aggressive in that situation, but there's the score from Kawamura. He's just left Vague in his dust.
Great finish by Pender.
And when we get to the end of this tournament, Pinder will be one of those players where he might not get rave reviews. You know, if Australia end up on the top step of the podium, he might not be the headline grabber. But they aren't being there without him. They're not going to get there without him. They haven't got this far without him. He's put in some good shifts.
Yoshi trying to go up against McDowell White, and he scores. Trying to keep this close, Japan back to 15 points. Alley-oop! How about Keanu Pinder flying in for the two? Kawamura again.
Yoshi just grazes the net.
Froehling not allowed to advance like he wants, so he settles for that jumper, short jumper. Kaminaga over to the corner, and Sato strokes the three-pointer. And just like that, they cut it back to a 14-point deficit. Japan just got to keep playing hard. You got a chance. Three-point shot huge to their chances today, obviously. They've hit 12. Australia have nailed 11 themselves. Yeah. That was the first for Takuma Sato.
5 from 7 in this second half for Japan. I think that's what's forced Coach Kelly into that timeout, because he knows that they don't want to see Japan get hot from outside, because things change really quickly when they do.
We're playing the way we want to play. Transition defense, we're jogging back. You got 10 seconds to get back. You'll have a sub coming in. Then, Maka, you cannot stand here and your guy run up and yell at this guy who's running toward you to switch. Talk, touch, switch. Offensively, empty corner pick and roll. Drags a step up, roll.
Who's up there, 1, 2, 3?
One stop right here.
Calling the team out, always good to see. You know, you're still leading by 14, but Coach Kelly has plenty of experience to know that 14 isn't a big lead against most teams, let alone against a team that are averaging 100 points a game. So just asking for a little bit more from his team as he brings Tom Maker back in as well. So that will certainly help some of their defensive presence.
Well, Australia's still up by 14 points. This is the do-or-die situation, obviously, for both teams. And right now, it's Japan that had their backs to the wall here in the quarterfinals. Wani Suaka right off the bench and hits a three. How about that from number 6? Tominaga from deep. And somehow Japan did not come up with that basketball. McDowell White in a little bit of trouble. Passes out to Maker. Look at the vision of Thon Maker.
He's becoming the all-round package, isn't he, Thon Maker? You know, the facilitator, the passer, the high-flying dunker, the defensive rim protector. So many titles you can put against him. Turnover for Japan.
Sato stepped out of bounds.
Just wonder if Coach Hovas has got a plan B at the moment. It's just try and do what we're doing, but do it better. No major changes to the way they've approached this game from the opening tip to where we are now. And they trail by 19.
Good defense. Kai Taves, who's come into the game. 7 seconds on the shot clock. A 19-point advantage for Australia, and good defense again from Innoyu to knock it away, but Maka gets it. Now Thon Maker catches and scores.
And I'm confused why they continue to switch. When Maker sets the screen, you cannot switch. It's that simple. You have to roll with him.
Good D, but it goes off of... Oh. goes off of Maker.
And that's what Kai Taves brings you there. He's the only guard that could put that kind of pressure on Thon Maker in that situation.
Japan might have gotten a break there. Australia with their biggest lead, 21 points. Late in the third quarter. Kai Taves almost lost it. Sato back outside. Look at Waniswaka. Tominaga has to put it up. And Australia going to hurry. 5 seconds. They pass it up to Waniswaka. He puts it up. And boy, relentless, the Boomers. But they come away empty on that possession, but it doesn't really matter. They are in command at the end of three quarters. Australia lead at 75-54.
And you have to give some credit to Japan. They did try really hard in that quarter. They put some effort in. They shot well from outside, but Australia just too strong across the board. They're versatile. They've got a well-balanced roster, inside threats, outside threats. You know, they're playing well on both ends of the court. And it's tough to see how, without radical changes, Japan can change anything in this final quarter. Like I say, they've not made, I don't think they've instigated a plan B in this game. I think they've just tried to make plan A work better, and it's not come out that way. They now trail by a game high 21 points. Biggest cheerleader on the bench there, Watanabe. It's not been enough. You wonder what impact and what difference it would have made if he was on the floor. My personal opinion is huge difference. I think Australia would still be in the lead looking at the way they played today. But I think it's single digits, maybe at most 10, 12 points will be the gap, and Japan will be in this game with a chance to win it in the final quarter. Whereas as it stands, this is a mountain for Japan to come back from.
Courtside 1891 app, folks, just scanning that barcode. You get all the video streams, schedules, and scores. It's where you want to watch all of your international basketball. Also get the FIBA Asia Cup app. Can't emphasize enough how much I use that thing. That's how you have all this information right at your fingertips, isn't it?
Yeah, absolutely.
Faked handoff, and Hatemoto goes in for the dunk, and he's fouled as well by Thon Maker, challenging the shot.
Maker ending up on the other side of a poster. Rare that we see that. That's one for Hatemoto to have as a keepsake.
Yeah, he definitely got him on the arm.
Yeah, I think he might have clipped his head as well.
And you like to see that emotion from Hatemoto. Still even down by a lot of points, and that'll frustrate them again when you're trailing. You just got to make those free throws.
And today it feels like they've asked Hatemoto to kind of make up for the missing Watanabe.
And Thon Maker goes the other end and gets shouldered out of the lane. So Maker's going to go to the line.
Interesting. Obviously, throughout this game, we've talked about that fan vote for the MVP within the tournament. And it's tough to vote for any particular Australian player because they just spread the load so well. You know, there's no one superstar in this Australian lineup. Thon Maker will get a lot of the headlines for the way he plays the game, but I'm not sure that you can vote for, you know, pick one particular player that has done it all.
Yeah, Australian fans can vote for Thon Maker. To go to the FIBA Asia Cup website, FIBA.basketball/Asia Cup/2022. And Luke Evans did a great job of getting that ball. Here he is going up against McDaniel. He's got to hurry. Nishida steps to his right. They were fortunate to get a shot off there. It looked like they were going to turn it over. Froehling. And just encountered a little bit more defense than he was anticipating at first. And Nishida passes it out to Suda, who finally hits one, but it's not going to count.
I think that might be why Mitch McCarron was smiling as well there. Just to say, we know how deadly you are from outside. You haven't hit one yet like that, so. And I can understand this change as we see Maker head into the bench and Vague come in. If I'm Coach Kelly, I'm looking at the other end of the floor and seeing Watanabe sitting on the end of the bench, and I'm thinking, not sure I want the same fate for Maker and the impact that would have on their chances here. So I wouldn't be surprised if we don't see Maker again today if Australia can hold Japan away.
Tagashi for three. Well, Japan might go down, but they're going to go down shooting those three-pointers. Trying to make Australia comfortable with a little bit of pressure, and now a chance to run for Tagashi. Is he going to pull up on the three? No, he's going to get in. And the defense from Maka forced him to turn it over.
He's fortunate, McCarron, not to get a foul called.
Slick pass from Maka on the attacker, and then he misses the shotter. And Luke Evans with the rebound. Again, another chance for Japan to run. And for the second time, Japan, ooh, look like they're going to turn that over.
Yeah, Coach Hovas screaming exactly what I was miming here on the table.
Nishida. Shoot to Nishida.
You're on the floor. We, as a team, shoot the ball. We are here to shoot threes. You had space.
Tominaga's going to come out, and now Hovas will tell him once again to shoot it in both Japanese and English.
And maybe using some words that technically are in neither.
Tagashi, another three, and he shoots it over Pinda. 77-62, back to 15 points.
Tagashi just wasn't a threat in those first three games. He woke up in that fourth game, that quarterfinal qualification game against the Philippines.
Oh, fouled by Harimoto on the three-point shot. Wow. And how many times have Australia come down and hit a big three to answer a run?
That's huge. That really is. And you're absolutely right. Every time Japan have kind of got that motivation, that spur, that bit of momentum, Australia have just canceled them out.
This is Tagashi shooting over the outstretched hands, arms rather, of Pinda. And Vague does not make the free throw, so it's back to an 18-point deficit. Harimoto, ooh, back outside to Tominaga. Make it another three-pointer for him.
23 points for Tominaga now. It's just sublime. For me, I think he might be the best shooter in this tournament.
Pinder open, and a chance again for Japan. Well, you never know with that three-point shot. You can get back into the game in a hurry. Suda for three! Look at Japan go! They have cut the deficit to 12 points!
And this is the nightmare that Coach Kelly will have been having building up to this game, watching Japan in full flow. Suda spotting up and draining another three. Tominaga, Togashi. And this is the problem they've now got. Who do you stop? Japan have now got shooters in flow. Not one, not two, but three shooters hitting big shots that are now feeling confident. Japan are a confidence team, and it's now for Coach Kelly to find a counter to that.
Hey, I know you guys just heard it there, but three of those three were avoidable. We switched. Sam, you back off. KP, you help out of the corner there. I don't know who else backed off, but they've made four shots inside the paint. Okay? All game. So no fouls. You're doing great. They're going to make a few offensively right now. Drags and step-ups. Drags and step-ups right now. Let's go horns. Shuffle.
Don't shuffle.
Yeah, Boos out there. One, two, three.
They go under restring. Set the first one.
That's a fair point from Coach Kelly. What are you trying to defend? They've been no threat in the paint whatsoever in today's game. Their only threat is from outside. Why are you sagging off? Why are you not just stepping up and throwing yourself at those shooters?
The only thing I'd say is that some of the Japanese players, they have been getting into the paint. Their penetration, then they kick it back out. Vague. It looks good.
It is good! And that's why, for me, Australia are favorites. They have so many different weapons. They can take you inside and score. They can step out and hit threes.
Tominaga, and that's what happens if you do go out and guard him.
You need the rim protection. You need someone to rotate and help out. But at this stage, I'd rather Tominaga did this than shoot a three.
Look at him. They swing it. Dukas can shoot it as well, and he does.
Oh, wow. This is a wonderful game now. It's just fully opened up.
In or you? Nobody in for the rebound. It doesn't matter because he drills it.
This is unreal. Both teams playing exceptional offense.
Here's Vague. And the rejection will not count because the foul is called. 5:53 remaining. This thing is not over.
Feeling we're going to end up with a high scoring game in the tournament here. It's two teams that know how to play offensive basketball at the highest level.
Well, if you remember how Hovas's Japan women's team played, they could be trailing and all of a sudden they could turn a deficit into a big lead.
Yep.
Because they could force turnovers, they could hit a lot of threes.
And they run at pace. They're playing the game at pace. They're not taking their time to get shots away.
Evans tasked with guarding Thon Maker. Maker has to take a very difficult shot, and he hits it right at the free throw line. I mean, that's like a hook shot.
But for me, that's why the guards got helped out. As soon as Thon Maker puts the ball on the floor, someone's got to jump down and try and strip it away. They've got the quick hands. They've got the quick guards to be able to do that. You can't just leave Evans to guard Maker one-on-one.
And Tagashi was able to get it up, but so concerned about having it blocked that he had to alter it. Here goes Maker!
Yeah.
So he doesn't only hit those dazzling shots from the free throw line with the shot clock running down. He goes down with a dunk, and there's Tominaga to get it back to a 15-point deficit, but now just under 5 minutes remaining. The clock becoming the enemy of Japan.
Tominaga's highest scoring game in this tournament. He's up to 27 now.
McCarron steps back, and Inouye hands it off to Tagashi. Tominaga, his range is anywhere. Another three, and he takes a bow. 30 points, 7 three-pointers. The Cornhusker strikes again.
How do you stop a player that can do that? That was a contested logo three, pretty much.
McDowell White. And now Tominaga, just shoot it now.
I don't think Coach Hovas would stop him, to be honest, the way he's feeling today.
He looks a little winded. Tagashi into the corner. Three-point shot. In single digits. Can you believe it? Japan refused to die. They have called the deficit back to 9 points. Dukas left open. Rims out. And the neutrals here in this Jakarta stadium loving what they're seeing here, but you feel they're getting behind Japan. Tominaga, he doesn't wait, and no! It was down and it came out. Unbelievable.
They got a huge thumbs up from Watanabe on the bench. That huge smile and a big thumbs up, say keep doing it. If I'm Coach Hovas, yeah, he's calling a timeout, and that's not for tactical reasons. That is purely to rest some guys.
If you can do one thing exceptionally well, you've got a chance to play in the NBA.
Yeah, you absolutely have.
And Tominaga said the other day, I want to try the NBA, but if it doesn't work out, well, he's got every right to dream.
I tell you now, whether he makes the NBA or not, he will have a wonderful professional career as a baller.
He will get paid. Yeah. Let's listen to Coach Hovas.
Good shot, good shot, good shot. 当に疲れただったらもう言って、もうすぐ交代する。そうね、もう9点差になったじゃないですか。
9
points. 3 possessions.
That's
3 possessions. 3 possessions. After, more 3 minutes. No use. No use. No use. I think more box out. Team, box out. Pass it. Okay. After, timeout 2 times. We got two.
Well, as we look at these highlights, the one thing that you can see with Hovas is I think he looks more excited right now than in any other time in this tournament, even than the Siri game, because A, his team has come back and they've shown they're not just going to accept a blowout defeat, and B, he senses that his players are starting to understand the possibilities if they play as he envisions.
Yeah, as a coach, you don't get much out of those huge wins. You don't learn much. You don't really benefit too much out of those huge wins. It's games like this where you see what personality, what spirit your team has. It gives you great hope.
Here's Australia. They want to go in for the kill if they can get it. Froling from the left corner. Proctor comes in and gets the rebound.
And that was the message. Box out. And Yoshi got caught napping a little on that one.
Here's Proctor. Got good size for the point guard. Finds Froling. And again, now Maker gets it, and he's fouled.
That's a good foul.
By Inouye.
That's a good foul. That's the right foul.
Well, Maker is 5 for 5 at the free throw line today.
They'd also be 100% if they didn't foul him in that shot. That would have been a 2 points guarantee.
Yeah. No, you had to.
Yeah, Maker has been one of their better free throw shooters, to be fair, throughout the tournament. 82% before the game, 100% in the game.
Look at how quickly Kelly's able to bring his guys in.
And I think that's what will push potentially Australia over the top and get them the win, is that they aren't going to be as fatigued. You know, Coach Hovas is now having to lean probably on this five for as much of the rest of the game as he can. It's just whether they can keep the motor going or whether they'll run out of gas.
I thought Maker's just having a fantastic game. 17 points, 12 rebounds, 5 assists, a block, and he has affected a lot of other shots. Perfect at the free throw line, 7 of 7, now 18 points. Tominaga, quick pass, and Inouye.
And that's what you were talking about with Maker. He didn't even make a move to block that, but just him being there changed that path of that shot.
So Proctor goes to the line, and Australia looked to be stabilizing things a little bit. And Watanabe has to look on from the bench and think about what might have been if he'd been able to play today.
Yeah, for Coach Kelly now, I'm looking at this and I'm thinking realistically, Australia probably needs 6 more points. If I'm honest, I'd say 6 more points will see them over the top. If they can get to, say, 97, 98 points, I think that may be a step too far in 2.5 minutes for Japan.
So Kawamura, quickest man on the court, brings it up. And Inouye kind of lost his footing and turned it over. And now Australia maybe content to take a little bit of time off the clock.
I'm surprised.
And Thon Maker fouled again, this by Yoshi.
I suppose you're okay to take a little bit of time off the clock if you've got Thon Maker as your backup.
So another timeout, 93-81. Brilliant performance. From Tominaga, but it's not been enough against a really good Australia team.
Driving session, 30 years. Okay. もうドライブ。自分の役割、役割。
Know your role.
Right? What's your role? みんなでしょ？もう11点差ですから、もう最後まであと2分がしかないです。
Okay?
まあ15をやるんですけど、もう一回アクチャンスあればアクしましょう。でもファウルしない、簡単に。逆にもう、hands up, hands up, vertical. Okay? 相手のペースが早くさせたいから。
Well, Thumb Maker plays like this, you would expect him to be in that Boomers team for the FIBA Basketball World Cup.
Yeah, I mean, think
he,
so.
He has been
dominant. It's just his versatility.
Yeah,
well, you know, that's another thing. If you want to play him at five, you can play him at five. He can play all the way down to three, potentially even two if you wanted to go crazy. And, you know, particularly on the defensive end, I think he could defend at the two. And that within tournament play is gold dust. To have a player that can do that, to give you that amount of versatility, that amount of options on both ends, that's huge. That really is. Listening to that Coach Hovas timeout, though, I love that as a phrase, know your role. Saying that to your players, don't worry about what other people are doing. What is your role? What are you on the floor to do right now at this point? What do we need you to do? And as long as each player knows their role, then you're in a good place.
Well, stays perfect at the line, 9 of 9, 21 points for Thon Maker, along with his 12 rebounds and 5 assists, and the block and a lot of altered shots. Here goes Yoshi, ooh, passes back out. Harimoto, and fouled while attempting a three. So Vague was fouled while shooting a three. He made the three, but he missed the free throw, and now Harimoto is fouled. Was that a three or a two?
I'm not sure. That's
I mean, knowing Thom Hovas, he's not allowed to shoot the ball inside the arc.
That's three. So. It's three from five from the field today, 75% before today's game, so reasonably good free throw shooter. I think you'd expect him probably to miss one of the three. Probably jinxed him for the second now as well. Japan, it's the defensive end as well, though. Are they going to step into some pressure now? Are they going to pressure the ball more? They absolutely can.
Well, they get the basketball back. He missed free throw. Catch a break there. Tominaga.
No.
You are joking! This kid is special.
That is unreal. That is a true logo three.
33 points. Now Vague, and it's given Japan a little bit of hope. And they turn the ball over. Here comes Kawamura.
You know who they got to look for. You know who they got to look for.
They got to find him. Oh, it's going to be Togashi for three. And Australia able to get the rebound.
And this is the first time I've seen Australia in the entire tournament a little bit panicked. They've looked completely cool customers for the whole tournament. They looked fretting. Oh, look at that shot. The distance is just
this
unreal.
This is incredible. He's beyond, he's inside the logo.
His heels are inside the center circle when he's taking that shot. And that's not a rushed shot. That's not a panicked shot. That is him just going, this is my shot. I've got space. I'm going to shoot the ball. It's within range.
Eyebrows.
Phenomenal.
Eyebrows being raised.
And you're right. There will be scouts and coaches around the world that are watching this game and thinking, man, we need to get someone to see his games next year. We need to find out about this kid.
Can you imagine the marketing potential with that?
Wow. Yeah, there's some money to be made on the back of Tominaga brand if he plays like that consistently.
Togashi, another three. Well, he had to take it. Under a minute to go. Australia looking to kill this thing off.
Got to put some on-ball pressure if they still want to win this game. It feels like they've stepped away from the game now. No on-ball pressure from Tominaga.
They don't want to foul now. Into the corner, Reese Vague. Count it! Well, as automatic as Tominaga seems to be, Reese Vague is pretty close as well. Maybe his range isn't as great.
His fourth triple of the game. He has been very impressive. His best game of the tournament by far.
Ah. And Togashi throws it away. So 25.4 seconds remaining. Australia up 99-85.
And I'm sitting here applauding Japan.
Me too.
Yeah.
I'm applauding both teams.
Yeah, I am. Just for the fight that the Japanese team have put out today. You know, Australia, they move on to another day. They'll get their applause another time. For me, just the Japanese team have given us a game.
Oh, tremendous.
They really have entertained us.
Well, they throw it away again to Kami Kawamura. He's just going to go all the way. Now he's going to give it back. Three-point shot. And that'll probably do it after they cross midcourt. Terrific, terrific effort from both teams.
Another amazing quarterfinal.
It wasn't necessarily close, yet it was tremendous. Look at that. Great, great job. Great shines of sportsmanship. Australia, you gotta tip your hat to them. They could have easily folded up their tent after they fell behind by 21 points. They came storming back. But Australia ultimately win it 99-85 to advance to the semifinals.
Yeah, huge amount of respect for Australia. They've come in and gotten the job done. You know, the way they will have had to look at that game is absolutely about getting the job done. They were favourites going into the game, and with a Watanabe injury, even more so. But a huge amount of respect and credit has to go to Japan, and not just for this game, for the way they've approached the entire tournament. I've loved watching that Japanese brand of basketball. You know, Hovas basketball, that's going to be exciting at the World Cup next year in Japan. You know, I tell you now, that is going to be an exciting team to watch. But Australia, they march on to the semi-finals. A big performance, an impressive performance, shooting perfectly throughout. They'll be happy with those statistics, but the rebounding battle is what killed the game. 51-29. That is dominance on the boards. And when you look at some of the stats that spews out on the other side of things, 17 second chance points, 36 points in the paint. Thon Maker, the superstar, with 21 points to lead Australia. And Coach Kelly could be happy. His team have overcome what I think has been their first proper challenge in this tournament.
Well, just a professional effort from Australia. They seem to get better and better. And of course, Thon Maker, the MVP of this game. I don't think there's any doubt about it, but they had Japan somehow managed to win. I think we know who would have been the MVP, Tominaga. You know, I think Japan coming into this FIBA Asia Cup had higher expectations. I mean, with Watanabe, I think they expected to get to the semifinals at least. And
I think a lot of it stems from that game against Iran.
Yeah, you know
that loss, it changed everything for them.
Had they been able to knock off Iran, they could have avoided Australia.
Yep.
But it's just it's been a great tournament because, you know, then Iran lost unexpectedly to Jordan. But this is a Japan team that has come here and showed a different face, I think, to the Japan teams that we've seen before. And it just goes to show with Tominaga, with Watanabe, especially those two guys. You'll get Rui Hachimura back eventually. They're a different team when he has full access to all these players. Now the good thing about it is also, I think Tom Hovas has been able to discover some other players that he's brought that he might not have. I'm thinking of the likes of NOU, who now will be in the rotation or chance to play in windows and maybe compete for a spot in the World Cup. We know Japan will be at the FIBA Basketball World Cup.
Yeah,
and there were
concerns, you know, looking at those World Cup qualification windows. Japan haven't played anywhere near their potential. They've struggled at times. But watching this tournament, I tell you now, those Japanese basketball fans, they will be excited for that World Cup. Okinawa is in for an absolute treat with this roster. If he can get full access to all these players, they're all healthy at the right time. You know, how far they go, that's kind of in the lap of the gods to a certain degree. But the crowd's going to be entertained, I can guarantee you that.
Yeah, 8 of 15 from three-point range, 33 points for Kasei Tominaga, 5 rebounds, and his range is, well,
I don't know if there is a range.
He's shooting the basketball when he gets off the bus. There is no doubt about it. And he's the Japanese Steph Curry.
I think he is.
You know?
I think he is.
So, I mean, he is just electric, but
And all this raving about Japan, for me, kind of tells you how good Australia are.
Yeah.
We kind of just accept that they are the favorites, and they are so, so good and clinical.
So you see Australia win, advance to the semifinals to face either Korea or New Zealand, who play next. Jordan will take on Lebanon in the other semifinal. Of course, those semifinals will be played on Saturday. But we've got one more game coming tonight, and it's going to be Korea, New Zealand. The road to the final. Well, Australia came here, defending champions, looking to press home the advantage. Watanabe couldn't play for Japan, but they still showed plenty of spirit with Tominaga, plenty of fight, plenty of absolute dazzling play. But Australia prevailed with Thonmaker. They advanced to the semifinals.
English or Japanese? No.